thank you very much for the opportunity to talk. So I'll try to put together a bit of a lecture. First bit's a little bit about Siemens, just so you're aware, what we do, who our customers are, what an industrial automation company might be like, that you may want to work for when you leave university. There's numerous competitors like us. Then I'll delve into the Siemens T3000 system, which you actually have a copy of here, which you can, I've tried to focus this so you can hopefully roll some of this into some examples or exercises on that system, and also try to relate back some of the technical project work that we're doing right now, how it relates to your lecture notes as well, and industrial applications of what you're learning. So if we start with the slides, first up, just a little bit about Siemens. I stole these lectures out of a sales presentation, so I'm not familiar with all the numbers, but it gives you a bit of an idea. The company of Siemens is quite a large global company. We have presence all over the world. It's based in Germany, originally a German company. In the mid-1800s it was founded. In Australia we have several offices. We have a sizable office here in Sydney. Our head office is in Melbourne. We do quite a lot of project work in Australia. Most of our manufacturing is done overseas. In Australia it's mainly project execution, management, delivery. A bit about the history of Siemens. This focuses on Australia and the Pacific region. So Siemens has many facets to it. We can see the first one we started was telegraph line. So the origins of telecommunications. We did years ago have Siemens Ericsson telephone handsets. You may remember, but we're no longer in the mobile handset business. I got out of that. But we do still provide large-scale telecommunication projects around the place. Australia's first electric streetcar. So trams and trains is a very big business. It's one of our major sectors these days. We provide a lot of train cars to Melbourne Trams and Queensland Rail. Television transmission, lights, so general electric lights and power around the place. Then we get into automation systems, automation and power systems for ships, which is starts to touch on the area that I work in. Medical, we have a very big medical department. Provide a lot of MRI imaging machines, things of that nature. The trains and trams again. And this is more into my sector, Kogan Creek Power Station. So you can see the little picture there. That's one of the newest and biggest in Australia steam turbine generator. It's an 800 megawatt steam turbine generator at Kogan Creek. It's about 400 kilometres west of Brisbane. We delivered that project, including the automation system for that power station as well, which is the area that I work in. Trains, HVDC, transmission networks, more medical, and wind turbines has been a big business the last few years for us. So that gives you an idea. There's many different areas and silos in Siemens. I can't possibly cover all of them. I can cover the area that I'm interested in, which is mainly in power generation. So my little department, we call it PGIE, or PIGI for short. It stands for Power Generation, Industry and Electrical. So we mainly focus on all aspects of power generation, steam turbine generators, gas turbines. It's been a big business recently, wind turbines. The automation of those systems. We're even now getting into the smaller embedded type generations, solar and smaller renewable power, things like that. We have a major system, major platform solution that we use to automate these processes, and we generally call it the T3000 system. So this is its official name up here, SPPA. T3000, which you have a version of, you have certain parts of it. So you can buy a cut down version for a very simple process, or all the way up to a full-scale system that we use in the large power stations. And they're currently getting this, our T3000 is currently being certified in Europe to use in nuclear power stations as well, so it won't be long before we've got those running out as well. So we break it down into various components. There's the control system proper, which we'll go through a lot of these components later on. These are just some of the other suites that we add on to it, sell with it. Diagnostic suite is to do with online monitoring, maintenance, things like vibration monitoring of machines to indicate the mechanical health and degradation of them over time. E3000 is electrical solutions product. There's a new standard of communications called IEC 61850, which is a way of controlling substations and switchgear, protection relays, that type of thing, over remote networks. I understand that's something you're looking at automating some relays here as well with the T3000 system. Service, we provide 24-hour service all over the world. P3000 process optimization, so again, it's an add-on suite of monitoring, continually monitoring the process, looking for any deviations from what would be the normal, flagging that to the operator and the customer. M3000 is it's a bit like a business LAN interface. So typically the control system for an industrial process or a power station will sit in its own little secure island away from everyone else's normal LAN machines, so that it doesn't get corrupted with whatever viruses and whatnot, right? But we usually do have to make an interface somehow via various firewalls and different zones and whatnot. So this provides some software to provide that interface. R3000 is turbine controls, so controlling turbines, the challenge is to do with the speed of the process. You need very high speed processing to properly control those turbines, that provides that. And the S3000 is another add-on to make a simulator, a full-scale replica simulator for whatever industrial process you have. So a bit about industrial processes. Hopefully you've got a concept of what an industrial process is. There are many different kinds. The ones that I work in are mainly powerhouses, power stations, power generation. They have their unique problems and challenges. So there's many different industrial processes. You can think of what one might be a manufacturing process. When I was at university, I visited a Smith's chip factory where they had a production line of making the chips, mixing the batter, cooking them, salting them, putting them into bags, packing them into crates. So that would be an example of a manufacturing industrial process. That's what we would generally call a batch process, because you've got, at the end, you've got even partway throughout the process, you've got a large storage or a large batch of bits that you can then use for the next one. So the whole production line doesn't have to be continuous. Probably the main challenge, I'd say, with power generation process is that it's a continuous process. It has to be running all the time, either it's on or it's off. And what you're making electricity power, that's a volatile commodity. So you can't really store it anywhere, although they're trying to do it these days with batteries, but forgetting that part of it. When the customer turns on their light switch, they expect the power to be there straight away. So the power stations have to be able to produce it straight away, virtually instantaneously. And to get the process, to turn the process on and off, is not a simple task. For these types of power stations, it can take several days. You start with a power station that's all cold and ambient. It'll take you several days to go through all the startup procedures, warm everything up and get it up to full load so that you're producing power. So what it means for the control systems is that they have to be highly available and highly automated, because you can't expect people to be there 100% of the time doing absolutely everything. So the control systems take that place of keeping it online 24 hours a day. So this is just a bit of a picture of one of our projects we provided recently in Queensland, Diamantina Power Station. It was 240 megawatts combined cycle power station. I have a bit of a picture of the detailed process a bit later on. That's typical of what we provide. So the actual gas turbines and steam generators were provided out of Europe, manufactured in Europe. In Australia, we did some of the control system design for it. We had various people up there commissioning for several months. This is just a bit of an overview of the industry that I work in, that our power generation business sells into. So we can see the map of Australia on the left. Gives a bit of an indication of major power stations where they are. So that's the Diamantina power station described before. It provides power to the Mount Isa mines up there. So up here, this part of the grid is not connected to the main part of the grid, so they have their own island supply of power. Kogan Creek power station is just here. That's like I said, probably the newest and biggest steam turbine generator in Australia. New South Wales, if you're familiar with the power station in New South Wales, we recently did a project at Mount Piper out near Lithgow, near Warrawing. It was out there for several months. Other power stations, Eraring, Bayswater, Vales Point, all centred around the Hunter Valley here. In Victoria, the major base of power stations is in the Latrobe Valley, we're all centered around that area. There's numerous of similar size down there. This is showing mainly the wind farm infrastructure has gone on west of Melbourne there. A few little power stations around Adelaide. Adelaide, South Australia is not fully integrated. Their grid is not fully connected to the rest of the mainland, so they're kind of their own island state. Perth, Mooja Power Station, we've had a lot of work over in Mooja. Mooja, that's the centre of power for the Perth region. And Perth is really not connected to the rest of the grid. In fact, they've got a lot of their own little island grids, you can see over here. So every one of those little squares is its own power station, not connected to anything else. There's only a little bit of interconnection here. So this shows the main grid, what we call, I don't know, the national grid. It has various names over the years. Its current name is AEMO, Australian Energy Market Operator, looks after the grid. It's an interconnection between Queensland, New South Wales and Victoria, mainly. There is some smaller interconnections into South Australia, and there is a HVDC link called Basslink over to Tasmania. To trade power, but the main trading of power is done between Queensland, New South Wales and Victoria. So these show the transmission lines in Queensland, where I'm from. The main transmission line is a 275 kV spine running all the way up the east coast, basically, and there's only little connections off it. In New South Wales, it looks a bit more like a grid pattern. A bit more load around the place and then into Victoria. Okay, so I'll just show you a few bits of a project I'm currently working on. This is currently our largest project at hand in our department, is Stanwell Coal-Fired Power Station. It's located just outside of Rockhampton, Queensland. So it's about 600 kilometres north of Brisbane, about 50 k's in there, something like that. The power station itself was built by the Queensland government in the early 1990s. It was around 1992, they commissioned most of the units. So it's been running for almost 20 years with their original control system. The original control system was a mix of Siemens from two generations ago, so a bit like the T3000, but two totally different generations ago. It also had a lot of other little electronic controllers and a Hitachi system as well. Most of the mechanical equipment is from a Japanese manufacturer called Hitachi. So they're one of our competitors, I guess, on a global scale. They provide large scale electrical equipment like this. They made a lot of power stations in Queensland at that time. So our job is to go in and renew the control systems. Basically, the control systems have reached the end of their life. Back then, they were generally only designed to last about 20 years. These days, they're generally only designed to last about 10 years, just because of the computer system nature of them. 10 years is enough. You really need to renew it all. Otherwise, you're trying to run old software. Some of these old things have got very old versions of Microsoft DOS or Unix or whatever that you have to go and try and maintain to keep the power station running. So we go through and we clean all that stuff out, provide it with a new control system. We also have newer, more advanced control concepts as well. So we try and improve the level of automation, so reduce the amount of work that the operators and maintainers have to do. Also improve the efficiency of it. Obviously, the better the efficiency of the power stations, the less things like CO2 emissions are coming out of it. So that's one way to reduce emissions, is to improve efficiency. So a bit of an overview of the big bits of the power station. You recognise this? This is the stack, the main stack where the exhaust gases come out of. There's four little pipes at the top. You can see a little bit of smoke. So on some days the smoke there is visible, some days it's not. You just see in this picture. These two things here is the cooling towers. So this is only water vapour out here. So what they have is a cooling water circuit where we need to take quite a lot of heat out of the cooling water. It's done by an evaporative process here. And this is the steam vapour evaporating off it. So usually the general public think that this is the smoke here at the power station, but it's not. This is the smoke out here, it's just water. These four little brown towers here we call the boiler houses. So that's where the top of the boiler house is in there. So there's four units on site. They're 4 by 365 megawatt units. So all up it's about 1500 megawatts. It's one of, probably not the largest, but one of the largest, one of about four or five largest power stations in Queensland. At the back here, this is the coal handling system. So these are overland conveyor belts. We call these the main coal feeders. So these rise up about 10 stories or so to feed coal into the top of the coal bunkers and down to the mills. Out the back here, we call these precipitators, the flue gas cleaning system, so the gas coming out is cleaned up before it's sent up the smokestack. The smaller boxes at the front, you can't really see here, we call these the turbine halls. This is where we house the turbine generators. The rest of the stuff you see on site is usually auxiliary systems and services like water treatment plants or water supply or maybe chemical plants, chemical processing plants, admin buildings, maintenance offices, that type of thing. So we can drill down into the industrial process itself of what a power station looks like a little bit more on the inside. So starting at the back, the dirty end. There's usually some sort of coal processing plant. Here, Stanmore Power Station receives all of its coal via a rail network in Queensland. Some places will have a mine immediately next door in Overlandcover. So then we have a little distribution system to get the coal into the coal silos. They sit above, we call these mills or pulverizers. They take coal that's the size about that chunks, and it crushes it up into a powdery, kind of like chalk powder, to blow into the furnace. We have fans. These here we would call FD fans, forced draft fans, because they blow air into the furnace. So you need three things to make fire. You need air, fuel, and source of ignition. So here's the fuel going into the furnace, here's the air. For the source of ignition, we start up with oil guns. So we have oil guns that we stick in initially. We burn a lot of diesel oil to start it up. Once it's all hot enough and you've got enough fire in there, it provides its own ignition support, so you can remove the oil and the whole thing sustains itself based on the process. and then to make steam, you need to transfer the heat from the fire into the, we call these the water walls over here. So we need a source of water coming in. These are the boiler feed pumps that feed the water into the water walls. Heat and water makes steam. We call this the drum out here. So then we get saturated steam here. We feed it back through various hot parts of the boiler to superheat it. Instead of it just being saturated, it's got quite a lot of superheat in it as well. Then we send it out to the turbine. It goes through a multi-stage steam turbine, which is directly coupled to a generator. And this is the generator here. We'll come back to that. So then the steam loses a lot of pressure and temperature as it goes through the turbine. It's not quite condensed into water yet, it's still steam. So then it has to go through the condenser. In fact, this is where a lot of the heat for the cooling towers, you need to take a lot of heat away from the residual steam to condense it back into water. So you have to put it back into water before you can send it back around the process again. So this is the cooling water cycle over here. We saw before. These are the cooling towers. Cooling water at the bottom between the turbine and the cooling towers. So that's this process here essentially. So there's some cooling water pumps. There's a big reservoir of water at the bottom. It just goes around the condenser, takes a lot of heat away from the exhaust steam. And that energy is evaporated in the form of water vapor. So how do you manage the exhaust products of the furnace? Here, so we call that the gas handling system. It goes out the back here. These stages are to, we have various stages of heat exchangers to try and recover some of the heat out of it, but then mainly the precipitators will strip all of the fine ash and dust out of it, so that it generally comes out as non-visible smoke. There's usually a set of fans, a stage of fans at the back, called the ID fans, induced draft fans. And these two fans work in tandem. These push air into the furnace, these suck it out. So they have to be controlled in a coordinated fashion. And then the exhaust gas is blown up in the atmosphere. There are then various ash handling systems to take away the particulate ash that falls out the bottom of this process here. From the generator here, we then typically have what we call a generator step-up transformer to connect on to the main grid. So in Queensland, this particular power station, we have at this location here, we have a massive circuit breaker about the size of this room called the GCB, generator circuit breaker. It's actually three separate circuit breakers that operate together, three phases. Then it goes out to a step-up transformer, and then this is connected directly onto the national grid, onto the 275 kV transmission line in the other picture. And then this is another sector of our business, which is transmission and distribution. They take this and put it through the various transformers and feed it down to all the customers in their own houses. So that was a bit of a whirlwind tour of power station process. This is another one called Yanama Combined Cycle Power Station. This is a gas turbine, a little bit similar to the Diamantina one I showed you before. This is a project we just completed, and some people, in fact our two previous students, both had work out here. Where is it? It's in the absolute furthest point from anywhere in the middle of Western Australia. That's where the power station is, a town called Newman. It's, I forget how many, three or four combined cycle gas turbines with heat recovery generators on it. So we have a bit of a simplified overview of that process. So it's a different process again. The outcome's the same, producing megawatts to put into the grid. The input's different. The Stanwell Power Station is mainly coal. This place is mainly natural gas supply. So they have a pipeline providing them with natural gas. How do they burn the stuff? You can actually burn natural gas in a boiler, in a conventional combustion boiler like this. Some people do it, but it's not as efficient. It's more efficient to put it through a gas turbine like this. And what is this? I don't have a lot of experience with gas turbines, but my basic understanding is that it's an aircraft engine, just bolted to the ground. It doesn't go anywhere. You feed in the gas and light it up and away it goes. That's the main gas turbine process there. The more complex part of it is what we call the heat recovery steam generator. So there's a lot of hot gas coming out the back of an aircraft. So we feed some water through heat exchanger tubes and try and recover that energy. And how do we do that? So this bit over here looks a lot more like the conventional steam water, steam turbine cycle that we had before. So we've got feed pumps, they go through a boiler, it generates steam, goes through a steam turbine, condenses again, there's a cooling water circuit, and then we generate it. So there's really two different processes that are tacked on back to back. I think the overall efficiency, a gas turbine by itself is only something in the region of about 30% efficient. When you put a heat recovery steam generator on it, the entire efficiency of the whole thing can come up to about 50%, which is fairly high. The efficiency of the Stanwell power stations that we saw before is about 36-37% efficient. Doesn't sound like much, does it? Look up that and see how it compares to like your car engine. I forget what those numbers are, they're not much better. The best you get out of a coal-fired power station anywhere in the world is probably about 45%. So one of the advantages of heat recovery steam generators is they're one of the highest efficiency processes going around when they work. Okay. So how do we go about automating these industrial processes? I have to speed up a bit. So this relates back to your lecture notes. You've got a section in chapter 7 on what a PLC is. We assume you've got an idea of what a PLC is. It's a bit like a computer, except it's designed to operate in an industrial environment continuously. What we want to try and minimize is the number of Windows restarts on your industrial PLC. You don't want to be constantly restarting it or updating software. You know, it has to be highly available, reliable, those types of things. So what is a DCS? Distributed control system. It's a common term we use in the industry. It's a bit of a blanket term. A lot of people forget what it actually means these days, I think. It just gets thrown around. But what it really means is where you have several PLCs, and you each PLC will control part of the plant, and then you bring them all together, they're all networked together in a coordinated fashion to achieve the final outcome. So as an example, in our Stanwell project, we'll have one set of PLCs for the air and gas system, for example. We'll control the fans here in this exhaust gas system. We'll have an entirely different PLC for each pulverizing mill, of which there will be many. We'll have a separate PLC again just to manage the conveyor plant. One to manage the steam system, one for the turbine, one for the generator electrical, one for the condenser cooling water. So we have, well, for example, our Stanwell project, where we've got 14 AS, as we call, 14 sets of PLCs to break the whole process down into subsystems. And one of those PLCs, we call the unit coordinator, is responsible for managing the entire output. So it's like the final control and output of the power station. So that's all it really means, connected together. And in some cases, they're designed so that they can separate on the network and they'll continue running independently. Some cases, not. You know, we specifically monitor that they're all running and they're all connected together, otherwise you shut down the entire process. So a bit into what T3000 looks like. This is an overview of a classical DCS. So the general components you need.